Resuming debate of the prise de débat, the Honourable Member for Davenport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's an absolute honour for me to rise today and speak to C-30, the Budget Implementation Act, on behalf of the residents of my riding of Davenport. Last time I spoke on the budget, I actually ran out of time, so I'm going to do my very best to be far more succinct today. Mr. Speaker, the truth is this is a historic budget with a huge number of measures that's going to make a big difference in the lives of Canadians. And in fact, in 10 minutes, it's virtually impossible to touch on all the reasons I believe that we need to pass the Budget Implementation Act and to relay all the things that matter to Davenport, never mind all the important measures that it contains for people right across this country. So instead, I'm just going to focus a little bit on a few key measures that may be talked a little bit less in the House. So the first ones that I want to talk a little bit about is the federal $15 minimum wage. I want to talk about some of the additional measures and funding for immigration. And I also want to talk about the huge increase in funding for a new national action plan to end gender-based violence. But before I do get to those, I do want to say that there are two huge game-changing segments of Budget 2021 that I'm super excited about, and I truly believe are once-in-a-generation investments in our future, and that they will be key to the future economic prosperity and jobs in Canada. And that is, Mr. Speaker, that we're building a national childcare program that is aiming to bring childcare fees down to $10 a day. We are modeling it on what Quebec currently does. This is a huge, huge announcement for Davenport residents and to families here in my riding. We're located in the downtown West Toronto, where the childcare costs are among the highest in the country. So I know that they're really happy with this announcement. I'll also say to you that Christine Lagarde, IMF president, when she spoke to our Prime Minister in July 2016, one of the things she said to our Prime Minister was, to boost growth, we need to employ more women. She had indicated at the time that the participation rate for women was 82% in 2015, which was well below the 92% level for men. And she also indicated that more women receive university degrees here in Canada, but more university degrees than men, but their labor participation rate is 7 percentage points lower than men's. And thus, there was a lot of room to tap into the underutilized female labor force to anchor strong economic growth. And I'm delighted that national childcare will absolutely enable that. It's good for women, it's good for our economy, and it's absolutely critical for Canada's success in the future. I'll also say to you, the second game-changing element for me in Budget 2021 is a green restart to our economy. Of all the letters and telephone calls that come into my riding of Davenport, if we exclude anything related to COVID, a green recovery and a green restart is top of the list. And I'm delighted that Budget 2021 confirms that a green recovery will be a core part of our strategy to create 1 million jobs. And in addition to the already $60 billion that we've already invested in climate action and clean growth since 2015, we have committed an additional $18 billion in Budget 2021. So these new dollars are going to be allocated for more investment in renewables, in carbon capture, to protect 25% of our land and water. And I know that this is all in addition to the plan that we've announced in December 2020, which is outlined in a report called A Healthy Environment and a Healthy Economy, where for the first time in Canadian history, we actually included a very specific, transparent cost of plan on how we're going to reach our targets, our emissions reductions targets by 2030. And I want to note that we have become more ambitious since that report came out in mid-December, where on Earth Day last month, we did announce that we were going to further reduce our emissions targets to 40 to 45% below 2005 by 2030. So Davenport environmentalists for years have been asking for a clear plan, and that has been delivered. And I really want to thank the amazing leadership of Ministers McKenna and Minister Wilkinson for ensuring that we are moving urgently and aggressively to net zero by 2050. Now, beyond these measures, Mr. Speaker, or now I see Madam Speaker, there are a number of other things I'd like to speak about. So the first is the fact that we're establishing a federal minimum wage of $15 per hour, rising with inflation. There are provisions to ensure that where provincial or territorial minimum wages are higher, that that wage will prevail. And this $15 federal minimum wage is going to directly benefit over 26,000 workers who currently make less than $15 an hour in federally regulated private sectors. And it's no secret that we know that the wages for most workers have not been keeping up with the cost of living and that many Canadians are struggling ahead. And I know that this $15 federal minimum wage will be very welcome by many across this country. And I know that there's lots of support by groups across the country. The next thing I want to talk about, Madam Speaker, is that the budget makes much needed improvements to our immigration system. I'm a very big believer that immigration is essential to Canada's economic future and a positive economic growth for us. With our declining birth rates and our increasing retirement rates, good immigration policy and funding will be fundamental to Canada's success moving forward. I myself am the daughter of immigrants. My parents worked really hard to build a new life and to contribute back to a country that gave them a home and a safe place to raise their children. And indeed, Madam Speaker, 43% of my riding of Davenport are first generation. So they were born in another country. They've come here. They've specifically chosen Canada to be their home and to contribute here. And so my office is actually a very popular spot for many immigration matters. So what improvements does Budget 2021 make? Budget 2021 proposes to invest almost $430 million to deliver a new digital platform that would replace the current outdated legacy global case management system. It also proposes $74 million to enhance capacity and service standards within the client support center within the IRCC to ensure timely support by phone and email for inquiries related to the services offered by the department. And then it also offers $29 million to be shared between IRCC and the Canadian Border Services Agency to maintain enhanced processing capacity for temporary resident applications. And I just pulled out these three things, Madam Speaker. There's actually a number of other items. But what I want to say is this investment is huge. It's a game changer. It's key to ensuring efficient processing of new Canadians, of immigrants. Many of our offices are very much a bit of offshoots of IRCC, and the better systems we have in place to provide the most timely information to new Canadians, to new immigrants that are trying to come to this country, the better it is for everyone. And the faster that we'll be able to get them here and to get them to contribute to our economy. I also want to mention that we're also proposing a number of other measures to support temporary workers who come to Canada. And so among these are more dollars to support migrant worker-centric programs and services, to increase inspections of the sites that employ temporary foreign workers, and to help improve the service delivery of open work permits for vulnerable workers, helping migrant workers in situations to find of abuse to find a new job. And this is important to point out, Madam Speaker, just because we are determined to treat our migrant workers right. They do so much for us, from helping us within our agricultural sector to processing our foods to in our healthcare sectors. The final thing I want to point out is that we are providing some additional legal aid support, which I know is something very important to West Toronto Community Legal Services in my riding. It's to make sure that we provide the support that is needed from a legal perspective to refugee and immigrants who might need some additional support. So I'm going to spend the last minute and a half, because I know that I'm running out of time, to talk about another thing that I'm really excited about is our commitment to gender equality. And if we truly believe in gender equality, which I know we do, and we've done so much over the last 5 years, from gender balanced cabinet to proactive pay legislation to over $100 million for feminist and women's organizations tackling gender-based violence. And that's why I was delighted that we put in a historic amount of money, over $600 million, to enact a national action plan to end gender-based violence. it is absolutely critical that for us to truly achieve gender equality in Canada, we have to tackle gender-based violence. And I'm delighted that we are making this commitment in this budget and putting real resources behind it to make sure that we put a plan in place, to make sure we have a dedicated secretariat. So I think in closing, Madam Speaker, because I know I've reached the end of my time, I want to say there's so many elements of this budget that is game-changing. It will not only lead to economic growth and more jobs and a green recovery, but a more equitable and more fuller participation in our workforce. But it's also going to support our low-income earners, offer a better immigration system, and a real plan to end end violence against women. These measures set Canada to become a more prosperous, more compassionate, and more just society. I encourage all my colleagues to support this bill. Thank you, Madam Speaker.